Good evening. My name is Eunice Reiser, and I'll be your moderator for this evening. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord or God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by the letter J. In the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such name as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original names of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edge of the chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen and divine visions, and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, We teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitution objectives of the Institute are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, a so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticisms, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This evening, we will have a prayer by Dr. Nanette Ramirez, and our scripture reading will be 1 John. Our prayer will be given by Dr. Samuel Salas, and our scripture reading will be by Dr. Nanette Ramirez.
Good evening, class. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for all the blessings you give us with this stupendous revelation you give to our founder, the seven angel, as he's been called. And thank you for all this long life. Keep us in the safe manner. We are your faithful sons. We here to learn your purpose and plan of salvation. Salvation is very important in our lives. This is why we are created to be saved. I say all those things in the only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you. was this mountain so high I could not climb. For every step that I would take forward, Satan put me 3 steps behind. And there was this river so deep I thought I'd drown. Then a voice touched my soul so gently. It was Yahshua. When I cried out, he said, "Peace, be still, child, and let me lift you over." He said, so heavy, and I changed my name to despair. In the darkness came a light and someone standing there, my Savior and his glory. I ran for comfort when he said, "Peace, be still, I'm so glad.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I'll be reading out of the proper name version of the King James Bible. I'll be reading 1 John, the 5th chapter. Whoever believes that Yahshua the Messiah is born of Yahweh, and everyone that loves him, that begot, loves him also that is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of Yahweh, when we love Yahweh and keep his commandments. For this is the love of Yahweh, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For whatever is born of Yahweh overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcomes the world, but he that believes that Yahshua, the Son of Yahweh, this is he that came by water and blood, even Yahshua the Messiah, but by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of Yahweh is greater. For this is the witness of Yahweh, which has testified of his Son. He that believes on the Son of Yahweh has the witness in himself. He that believes not Yahweh has made him a liar, because he believes not the record that Yahweh gave of his Son. And this is the record, that Yahweh has given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has life, and he that has not the Son of Yahweh has not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of Yahweh, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of Yahweh. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hear us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. If any man sees his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life. For them that sin not unto death, there is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is a sin not unto death. We know that whoever is born of Yahweh sins not, but he that is begotten of Yahweh keeps himself, and that wicked one touches him not. And we know that we are of Yahweh, and the whole world lies in wickedness. And we know that the Son of Yahweh has come and has given us an understanding, that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Yahshua the Messiah. This is the true Elohim and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas and Dr. Ramirez. Tonight is Thursday night, which is our open testimony or lecture night. Would anyone on Zoom here in class like to volunteer, be the first speaker? Anyone? Okay. Our first speaker for this evening will be Dr. Samuel Salas.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's a wonderful night for all the audience in the world watching us. I want to go into something I was reading this morning, and I also read long, long time ago. The last three classes, we talked about the prophet Samuel. And I want to give some history of his background. We might have an understanding what was his purpose and heart. See, Samuel, he was a man, growing man. He was three things at the same time. He was judge, prophet, and high priest. And before that, before he born, he was a man. His name was Elkanah, who had two wives in that time. One was Anna. She cannot have babies. And the other one was Penina. She had five babies. And Anna, she was not so happy because she don't have a son. And she go to the temple in that time. And she was praying Yahweh, moving his lips. And the high priest looked at her and see her, she was moving her lips, but he cannot understand what she say. And he thought his name was, the high priest's name was Eli, or Eli. I don't know how you pronounce. And he say, I told you, lady, not to come over here drunk. And she say, I am not drunk. I asking my creator to give me a son. This is what I want. Well, I thought you were drunk. No, I am not. Go home, and Yahweh will provide what you're asking for. Then she went home, and Elkanah slept with her, and she was pregnant. And she had a baby. But before that, she promised Yahweh, if I have a baby, I give it to the temple to be something there. And when the baby born, the father used to go every year and have a something, a sacrifice every year. And he used to take the two wives, Anna and Penina. But this time, Anna, she don't want to go. She stayed home till the baby was a little older. And that happened when the baby was old enough. She take it to the temple, to Eli, and told him, you might remember me. I promised the baby to the temple. I promised give it to Yahweh. Who's, what's moving? Oh. And maybe the one in my pocket. I have in the pocket. Oh, I fix it probably. Thank you. And the boy was a little boy, and Eli had the baby, and Anna used to give or take to the temple one dress for the baby. As a priest, every year. And The boy was growing, and he lived in Silo, who was the city or the temple, Silo. And one day he was a little older, and he was in bed. So he was the high priest in bed. And Samuel hear a voice say, "Samuel, Samuel, Samuel," 3 times. And he get up, and he thought the high priest was calling him. He said, "What you want, master? You want me?" And the high priest say, "I didn't call you. You didn't call me." No, say, "I didn't call you. Go to bed, go to sleep." So he went to sleep, and he was catching the sleep, and he hear the voice again, "Samuel, Samuel, Samuel." And he get up and say, "Master, you call me? I told you I didn't call you. Go to bed." He went to bed and lay down in the bed, and he heard the voice again, "Samuel, Samuel." He said, "Master, did you call me?" "I didn't." Oh, Eli, he knew Yahweh was calling him. And he said, "Listen, if you hear the voice again, tell, I hear you. Whatever you want to say, tell me." You tell him that. Okay. He went to bed and he heard, "Samuel, Samuel, Samuel." And he say, "I am here. You can speak. I hear you." And the Spirit of Yahweh told him something is going to happen to his family. The reason why is this. Eli, the high priest, have 2 sons. One was Ophni, and the other was Phinehas. And they were not very honest. They waiting for the girls before they opened the doors of the temple, and sleep with the girls, and did other things. When they make the sacrifice, they pick up the best part of the sacrifice for themselves and give some to the high priest, and they keep some for them. And it was not good in the Yahweh's eyes. And Eli, next day, he went to approach him, but Samuel moved away. And finally, he catch him and say, "Hey, Samuel, tell me exactly what the Creator told you. Don't keep anything." He don't want to tell him what Yahweh told him. The 2 sons will be killed because they were disobedient and not too honest with him. And he's a high priest said, "Well, whatever had to happen, let it happen." It's the only thing he said. Years went by, and the Hebrews used to be with problem with the Philistines, and it was very close to be a war, and Eli's son went to war, and they were killed, as Yahweh told Samuel. And the Hebrews lost the war, the battle. And one man escaped. He was full of dirt in his hair, running away. And the people started to say, hey, 1 minute's coming. And they start making a lot of noise. And the high priest said, what's happening? He was sitting in the chair in the front door of the place, of the temple. What's happening? And the man was running, approach, and he said, what happened? Why people making too much noise? Oh, I want to tell you something. We lost the war, and a lot of people of our people died in the war. And also, your two sons, they were killed. When Eli heard those words, his two sons, Ophni and Phinehas, were killed. He was little obese or big, and 98 years old. He was almost blind. He went back and hit his head and passed. He died. So he was fulfilled what the Creator promised or tell Samuel will happen. And Samuel born in the city of Ramah. And the spirits of the idols they used to worship was Dagon. And there is one place in the Bible, is Samuel 8 and 1. Can you read that, for please? 8 and 1, 1 Samuel.
1 Samuel 8 and 1.
Yeah, I got it. And it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his son judges over Israel. Now the name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second, Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in the ways, but turned aside after lucre, and took bribes and perverted judgments. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah, and said unto him, behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy way. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, give us a king to judge us.
Okay, thank you. Eunice Rice. And the people, they want a king. The reason why, Samuel, he was getting old. He also had two sons, but they don't walk in the same steps his father walked, Samuel walked. They were corrupt, they were judged, and they people bribed them, and they were not too honest. And the people say, when you go, who's going to be the two sons you have, which one is going to be the high priest? They are corrupt. So the elder people get together and they say, we want a king like the rest of the people. And Samuel said, let me ask Yahweh what he think about. And he told the Creator, they want a king. Well, tell them this, they might change their mind. The men, Samuel went over and talked to the people. Look at what's gonna happen. The men had to run in front of the king or the soldiers, and they had to work and give a portion of his harvest. And the girls, they be put perfume, they make food, and they be maids or servants. That's gonna happen. It's okay, we want a king. And Samuel went over and talked to Yahweh, saying, Yahweh, I cannot make change their mind. They still want a king. Well, ask, give them what they ask for. If they don't change their mind, there is, I want to tell you which one will be the king. See, Yahweh chose Saul. Saul was a very handsome man, tall. The people, all the people were smaller than him. The old, tallest one, he went to the shoulder. He have a lot of space bigger than the rest of the people. He was nice looking. And he have a father, well, not too wealthy, but he have some goats and donkeys. And one time, the donkeys escaped. And he told his son, son, go and look for my animals. Come back when you find it. And he went over, Saul went over and looked for, he had few people helping him to look for the animals. They were walking, walking, and they cannot find them. Finally, they went to a city. And they say, let's go to this city and ask if they don't see our donkeys. And one of the servants say, I hear in this town, this one man can tell you the future or can tell you things you don't know. Oh, let's go to the city to see if we can find and ask him where my donkeys are. So they walk into the city and they see a girl walking and they say, do you see the man at the mine, the one can help us to find our donkeys? Oh, yeah. Go right away because he's coming. He come to eat. He make a sacrifice and he is going to eat with a lot of people he invite. And then they run and they see an old man. He say, do you know the prophet, the people can help us? I am the one. Come over and eat with me. So they went over and sat down next to him and they eat. And the next day he said, oh, now don't worry about your donkeys. Your donkeys are already with your father. They return. They are down there. Don't worry about them. Oh, thank you very much. And the helper of Saul say, hey, we don't have nothing, no money to give him. We had to give him something for the favor he gave us. Our bread is too old. It's almost green. Oh, I have some pieces of silver. We can give him this thing. Okay. And things went by, passed away, and he went back to his house. But when he reached the town, his uncle came to him and he said, what the priest tell you? Oh, he tell us the donkeys are already home because Samuel told him, you will be anointed and will be the king. Also, he anointing him. But he didn't, Saul, he didn't tell his uncle he was anointed. And days went by, and he was ready for the war. The Philistines and the Hebrews, they were almost, and nobody wanted to go to war. And nobody wanted to help him. He said, help me, give me a hand. Everybody was so busy because the land was already distributed. Everybody was busy with the land. So he said, I have an idea how to make them help me. He bring a cow and made pieces of the cow and sent one piece of the cow to every tribe and con this message, if you don't help me, all the animals you have will be like this in pieces. Mm. So everybody say, okay, we help you. So they help Saul and they win the war against the Philistines. It was looking pretty good, Saul, as a king in the beginning. Yahweh loved him, but he made three mistakes. What was those three mistakes was? First of all, one, they were ready to go to war, and they say, nobody is supposed to eat till we finish fighting. Okay, we obey you, so nobody eats. But his son didn't hear the command. So he got a little straw, and he see a honey there, and he stick the hole in and suck it, and it was good. But he break the law. After he eat the honey, his eye open. He said, oh, if everybody eat, look it. They can see the enemy better. Look at what happened to me. So he disobeyed. He's supposed to be killed. People told his father, Saul, and he don't want to kill him. That was one. And the other one, it was enemies, and they went to war, and they win. But he see big cows and big lambs, beautiful. And it was they have a king. His name was Og. And he said, oh, please don't kill me. Take my animals, are nice and beautiful. And I give some present for you, but don't kill me. Okay, I don't kill you. And Samuel came and he said, what you did? Oh, we win the war. And he hear that voice, meh, meh. What those animals are? And he went to see, oh, you didn't kill those? Oh, no, I saved it because they're looking good. I saved it for a sacrifice. Mm-hmm. You disobey. I told you to kill any living thing, and you didn't. And who is this man? And the man was walking. Oh, thank you very much. You didn't kill me. The bad days are over. I am saved. And Samuel, he gets so angry, he got the sword and kill him, kill the king, because Saul disobeyed. Second time, and the third time he disobeyed, disobedience, what happened in the third disobedience? Okay. Let's see. Okay, let's see. Okay. They went to war and Samuel told Saul, wait for me 7 days. Excuse me. In the 7 days, I will come and make a sacrifice, and you can go to war, and you win. He had thousands of people with him. Saul. Excuse me. But people start deserting of him. He said, one day passed, 2 days, and people say, I better go home. I have something to do. He ended with 600 people only. Not enough people to fight the Palestinians. And he said, hey, Samuel, he didn't show up. Okay, thank you. He didn't show up, and look, at I only have 600 people with me. They might kill me. And he said, I better make the sacrifice. So he grabbed a lamb, slaughtered the lamb, made the sacrifice. He was working in. When he see the old man coming, who is that man? Oh, it's Samuel. And he went and approached him. Oh, Samuel, how are you? Oh, and Samuel said, what are you doing? Oh, I'm making the sacrifice because you didn't show up. And I only have 600 with me. You disobey. I tell you to wait for me. You know, all the time we make a sacrifice, we win. But this time, you went ahead. You didn't believe me. You didn't believe Yahweh. So Yahweh, Ishar, or Saul, don't have 100% of Yahweh. Yahweh refusing. He don't talk to him no more. No revelations. And he is wondering, what happened? Yahweh don't talk to me no more. And he said, he disobeyed, but I have another enemy. His name is David. He will be the next king. And he said, Yahweh told Samuel, go to Jesse's house. He have 8 sons. One of them will be the king. You see that, sit down in there and call him one by one, and whoever flash the light, and you know he will be the king, anoint him. Okay. Samuel went with Jesse and tell him, how many sons you have? 8. Tell them to come over and pass by me, one by one. The oldest one and the next, he didn't feel nothing. Normal. The 7 went by, and Samuel said, do you not have, you have 8 sons, and you only show me 7. Oh, the little one is in the field looking for the goats. It's a goat's keeper. Tell him to bring him over here. They call him, they bring him. In the moment he passed by, Samuel knows he was the king. So he anointed him, but he don't want Saul no more. And Saul, he have a hard time. He was an unhappy man and told the soldiers, hey, go to the town and bring me someone can play a music. It might be make me happy. Oh, one of those soldiers say, hey, I know one. His name is David. He can play for you. Bring him over. So David was playing for the king. And the time he played, the king was happy, no problems. Mm-hmm. It was nice and quiet. But when he stopped, he started feeling not too good. Mm-hmm. And one time, the people, the Hebrews used to be in war with the Philistines. And it was a mountain. One side, the Philistines were over there, and the Hebrews, they were on the other side. And in between was a big land. And every day, a big giant man came to the middle of the land. He said, whoever want to fight with me, come over. If you defeat me, my people will be servants of you. But if you soldier or the one fight against me in laws, you will be servant of us. He said that for 40 days, every day, in the morning and the afternoon. And one time, David, Jesse, one time Jesse told David, David, go and have some food for you. Three brothers are in war. Because the oldest ones, they were with Saul. And he took all the food and gave these 10 cheese for the captain. Give it to him and bring me something of the clothes of your brothers. That way I know they are okay. Okay. So Samuel went over and started watching the big giant man. That man was 6 cubits and 1 palm. That means a palm is 9 inches. And a cubit is 1.5 inches. That was 9 feet and a half tall. He was a tall guy. His name was Goliath. He would have an armor of metal in the head, and the arms, and the foot, and his weapons, they were heavy as a warrior. And he was yelling and everything, ha, 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 I can defeat any man of yours. And David said, who is that man? Oh, that's Goliath. That is a man, professional fighter. I can defeat him. I can beat him. Hey, don't say that. But people hear and went with the king Saul. He said, hey, this one man say he can defeat the giant. Nobody of you want to go and kill him or fight with him? This young man, he can go. And Saul, he started taking his clothes out of him, all his armor, and give it to David. You can wear this and that and that. And David start walking with this armor. He said, oh, I never trained to walk with these things. I better fight the way I feel comfortable. He take all those things away. And he was in his right clothes. And he have one of the weapons in those days. It was like a sling. And he have a little pocket. He grabbed 5 river stones and put in the little pocket. Why 5? Because Goliath had another 4 sons, brothers, excuse me. Goliath had another giant brothers, 4. 4 and 1 is 5. In case of they come, he can slay them too. He said, why you want to fight this big giant man? He's professional, he will kill you. No, I kill bears and lions. I know how where to hit, because David, he was to take care of the lambs, but when the bear or the lion grab a prey with the slain, he killed the animals. So he knew he can kill the giant, Goliath. So Goliath, he was challenged. And here came David. He said, I fight with you. You? He was a young and good-looking boy. And he said, I am not a dog. You can come over to hit me with the rods. I am not a dog. He said, David, he got one of the stones and start using the sling and throw the stones and hit right and the place was not metal, right in the front was an opening right here. And the stone is sticking there, and the big giant Goliath fall down. And David, he take his sword and cut his head. When the Palestinians see that, everybody runs. Mm-hmm. And the Hebrews chase them to kill them. And they win the war. David defeat Goliath. Well, this is the farthest I can go. And the reason why I give this class, that way we know exactly who Samuel was. He was chosen by Yahweh for his purpose and his plan. Thank you. Have a nice, good one. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Salas. Do we have anyone else that has a testimony or would like to give a lecture? If no one do, our next speaker will be the Dean of Ontario, Dr. Marlene Love.
Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
First time I've used this one. A little closer. I don't like that either. How about that? I think that might work. If anybody can't hear, just take a note, write it in the comments, and we'll fix it. Huh? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Good evening, everyone. It's good to be here. And man, I thoroughly enjoyed that recap from Solomon to David. And what we've been kind of going over, which has been the events beyond the River Jordan, as it were, and Samuel being a judge there, or a judge or a prophet, as it were. Because the prophets ran from Joshua after the death of Joshua at 110 years old, and Samuel, Eli being the last judge. And then you had Samuel, as Dr. Samuel Salas expressed, how he came into the fold, as it were, of being chosen by Yahweh. And everything that Dr. Samuel Salas expressed tonight, we read as events in the Bible that you can read thoroughly, and it's been admonished that we ought to read, or at least let the Bible reader read for you, and we can have the generalities of the story. Now, I really appreciated Dr. Samuel Salas expressing the deeds that Saul did, the three things that Saul did. And I missed it in the 13th chapter when the one he was looking for he not waiting for Yahweh, which I think was the second one, and then the other one was the third one. But nonetheless, the three things that Saul did, which was to disobey Yahweh, and subsequently, as Dr. Samuel Salas had a bad attitude, through and through. He had a bad attitude whereby he wanted some music and some songs, which David was brought to him unbeknownst to Saul of who David was actually going to be in the end of his life. And we read about Saul. Grab me the last chapter of, I think it's 2 Samuel 24 chapter, I believe it is.
Beginning?
Let me see. Samuel 24. No, I want 23. And let's hear about how Samuel, and how Saul ended. That was 24. First Samuel. Yeah, First Samuel, and then I'll do a. So what happens is Saul begins to have a hunt for David, and David's on the run, as it were, and David's has a group of men with him, and then Saul ends up going to war, and I think this is you can read with the Philistines. Yeah, I think I just read the last chapter of 1 Samuel is what I want.
First Samuel.
And so you have whereby Saul has three sons. Jonathan was one of the sons that befriended David, and they were close as they were rearing up together. And David had a great amount of respect for Jonathan because Jonathan would tell David that his father Saul was looking for him and always kept Saul one step ahead, kept David one step ahead of Saul because of the love that Jonathan and David had for one another. But yet Jonathan, doted to his dad and they went to war. And now we're going to read the last chapter just to kind of get a summation of what Mr. Solis had talked about as far as the type of man Saul was and what he last said at his last days on earth, if you would. So
First
if you can just
Samuel
start at one. Yeah.
31:1.
Yep.
Now the Philistines fought against Israel, and the men of Israel fled from before the Philistines and fell down slain in Mount Gilboa. Mm-hmm. And the Philistines followed hard upon Saul and upon his sons, and the Philistines slew Jonathan. And
Jonathan, that's David's friend, is that Jonathan? Mm-hmm. And the Philistines slew Jonathan that day. Okay, mm-hmm. Read.
And Abinadab and Machua, Saul's sons.
Mm-hmm.
And the battle went sore against Saul,
mm-hmm.
and the archers hit him. And he was sore wounded of the archer.
Saul was, okay.
Then said Saul unto his armor bearer, draw thy sword and thrust me through therewith, lest these uncircumcised come and thrust me through and abuse me. But his armor bearer would not, for he was so afraid.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore Saul took a sword and fell upon it. And when his armor bearer saw that Saul was dead, he fell likewise upon his sword and died with him.
Okay.
So Saul died, and his three sons, and his armor bearer, and all his men that same day together.
That's Saul. And that's the end of Saul and his three sons, okay? Of that nature or character that Saul represented, because we have in the textbook, and we've already read through it, that Saul depicted that satanic nature. You follow? And that death or the end of that, of that life is experiencing the end of that reign, that 40-year reign that Saul had. Keep reading a little bit.
So Saul...
Seven. Okay.
And when the men of Israel that were on the other side of the valley and they that were on the other side of Jordan saw that the men of Israel fled and that Saul and his sons were dead, they forsook the cities and fled, and the Philistine came and dwelt in them.
Mm-hmm.
And it came to pass on the morrow, when the Philistine came to strip the slain, that they found Saul and his three sons fallen in Mount Gilboa.
Mm-hmm.
And they cut off his head and stripped off his armor and sent into the land of the Philistines round about to publish it in the house of their idols and among the people.
Okay.
And they put his armor in the house of Ashtaroth, and they fastened his body to the wall of Bashan.
Astro is a god at that time, an idol that they worship, the Gentiles or the heathen, if you would. Read.
And when the inhabitant of Gibeah Gilead heard of that which the Philistine had done to Saul,
mm-hmm.
and all the valiant men arose and went all night and took the body of Saul and the bodies of his son from the wall of Bashan and came to Jabesh and burnt them there. And they took their bones and buried them under a tree,
mm-hmm.
at Jabesh and fast 7 days.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Two.
Yeah, two and one. Now that was the end of Saul. He got buried by Gad. Gad's a tribe. And now you got David. Dr. Samuel Solis said David was going to be the anointed one, the son of Jesse, the eighth son of Jesse. All right. And now you have David have grown up, and now he's here. This is after Goliath, and now you have what David has to say about Saul's death. Read.
Now it came to pass after the death of Saul.
This is 2 Samuel, first chapter now.
Right.
Okay.
Now it came to pass after the death of Saul, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, and David had abode 2 days in Ziklag.
Mm-hmm.
It came even to pass on the third day that, behold, a man came out of camp from Saul with his clothes rent and earth upon his head.
Now you have Saul fighting the Philistines and David's out fighting the Amalekites, okay? You got all these wars. And they were a warring nation, okay, Israel. Mm-hmm. And now you have this guy coming from Saul's camp coming unto David. Go ahead and read.
And so it was when he came to David that he fell to the earth and did obedience. And David said unto him, from whence comest thou? And he said unto him, out of the camp of Israel am I escaped. And David said unto him, how went the matter? I pray thee, tell me. And he answered, that the people are fled from the battle, and many of the people also are fallen and dead. And Saul and Jonathan his son are dead also. And David said unto the young man that told him, how knowest thou that Saul and Jonathan his son be dead? And the young man that told him said, as I happened by chance upon Mount Gilboa, behold, Saul leaned upon his spear, and lo, the chariot and the horsemen followed hard after him. And when he looked behind him, he saw me and called unto me, and I answered, here am I. And he said unto me, who art thou? And I answered him, I am an Amalekite. And he said unto me again, stand, I pray thee, upon me, and slay me, for anguish has come upon me, because my life is yet whole in me. So I stood upon him and slew him, because I was sure that he could not live after that he was fallen. And I took the crown that was upon his head and the bracelet that was on his arm, and have brought them hither unto my master.
Now this is this guy's story. This is Amalekite's story. Mm-hmm. And we just read in the last chapter, the 31st chapter of 1 Samuel, that that's not how that story went. It says Saul asked his own armor bearer, right, which is the Israelite, to thrust the sword, and he said he wouldn't even do it. Mm-hmm. And Saul took it upon himself to commit suicide because he didn't want that to be or a Gentile to, or the, what he said, uncircumcised,
right,
to,
right,
to take his life, mm-hmm, and to run him around. You follow? Mm-hmm. But this guy, he gonna come tell David some business. You follow? Now let's, yeah, finish, let's finish off and see what this faux pas causes this guy. Read.
11. Mm-hmm. Then David took hold on his clothes and rent them, mm-hmm, and likewise all the men that were with him. And they mourned and wept and fasted until evening, mm-hmm, for Saul and for Jonathan his son and for the people of Yahweh and for the house of Israel.
You see how Saul didn't mention the other two brothers there. He just mentions, right, Jonathan there, mm-hmm, specifically, and Saul. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
Because they were fallen by the sword. And David said unto the young man that took him, mm-hmm, whence art thou? And he answered, I am the son of a stranger, an Amalekite. And David said unto him, how wast thou not afraid to stretch forth thy hand to destroy Yahweh's anointed?
See, Saul, mm-hmm, Yahweh's anointed for the purpose that Yahweh had him set up to be. Read.
And David called one of the young men and said, go near and fall upon him. And he smote him that he died. Mm-hmm. And David said unto him, thy blood be upon thy head. But thy mouth has testified against thee, saying, huh, I have slain Yahweh's anointed. And, mm-hmm, David lamented with this lamentation over Saul.
Now he just made
Jonathan.
That he just made that accusation that he slayed Yahweh's anointed. But yet we read what actually had happened to Saul. Follow? David not knowing, because this is what we're experiencing through these events in time. And we have this migratory pattern, and people would say that Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt. They wouldn't read that this mighty hand and the will of Yahweh and the purpose of Yahweh, and that Moses didn't know where to go or how to go. When we delve in and start studying and seeing the mystery of what's expressed, even though it's in the Bible, mm-hmm, right, plain as day, that's in the Bible. Just as we talk about that, how Moses wrote that Genesis and how the Exodus becomes before Genesis. You, mm-hmm, follow? Right, it's flat as day, right there in one's Bible. If they take the time and see the how it's laid up and what's being said and what's expressed. Same thing here of how David would have known. Mm-hmm. And the principles of being anointed and what it meant to them at that time over here in Canaan's land and what they were to them trying to follow the dictates of Yahweh.
Right.
David was sending to his Jesse's flock of sheep. Didn't know nothing about anything. And then he comes to be anointed by Yahweh, comes to have the desire. One thing about before he killed Goliath, see, his thing was because it was of Yahweh, because he right, cursed Yahweh. Goliath cursed Yahweh. Can we find that real quick? Goliath. Find out why David took up an attitude about this Goliath character. Because what we're dealing with is Samuel, 17-ish. Is it beginning, maybe? and David's, David gets cooks his meal, takes it to this army, right? And he hears, this is what he hears. No, I don't need all of it because Samuel just had talked about it. It's fine. I just wanted to. You have, but David went to and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem, to tend cheeses. Yeah, I started maybe at 20.
Okay. And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with the keeper and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the trench as the host was going forth to fight.
No, let's go skip on down to 25. He bring this cheese to them and skip to 25. And all the men are gathered together talking about this Philistine now.
Right.
Read.
And the men of Israel said, have you seen this man that has come up, his daughter, mm-hmm. and make his father's house free in Israel? And David spake to the men that stood by, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living Elohim? And the people,
the armies of the living Elohim. We're talking about Israel. And we have to bear in mind that these events of time are still dealing with Elohim, still dealing with that spirit that's incorporeal, that they are being moved by and being led by. This is what's in David. This is what that light that Samuel saw in David in order to choose David, in order to pick David, because he's reading and living by this word. You follow? Because that word told him that he's going to look for, out of the 8 sons, that spirit that's going to dwell in a man. And now that spirit that dwelt in that man is coming to this, to the army of men that supposedly were also professional fighters, but didn't have the gumption or the wherewithal to take down Goliath.
Right.
Why is that? We have the Bible. Everybody has a lot of talk. A lot of different denominations, a lot of different theories, concepts, and opinions about their God, mm-hmm. their spiritual being, as it were. See, this is all. This is a war. Wasn't there war in heaven?
Yep.
You got a war nation, mm-hmm. and you have a little tyke coming along, just bringing some food. Didn't have no. It had no training at all. As Dr. Samuel Sala said, he just disarmed Saul's armor and took it off and keep your sword, keep your helmet. They're too heavy for me. Mm-hmm. I don't get down like that.
Right.
When it comes to what? Keep reading.
And the people answered him after this matter, 27. So shall it be done to the man that killeth him.
Mm-hmm.
And Eliab, his elder's brother, heard what he spake unto the man. And Eliab answered, anger was kindled against David. And he said, why camest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness?
See, his big brother talking about David, talking about what you doing up here anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Keep reading.
I know thy pride and the naughtiness of thy heart, but thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle. And David said, what have I now done? I only asked the question.
Mm-hmm. He asked that question.
Yeah.
He asked that question.
And he turned from him towards another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. And when the words was heard by David spake, they rehearsed them before Saul, and he sent for him. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine.
This is David now talking, having that light that Samuel saw that's in him in order to step up to fight this Goliath. Mm-hmm. You follow? These are spiritual principles that we see in Goliath in this story. And not just that he picked up 5 stones and he used one of them to slay Goliath. It's that spirit that we're looking at is in David, and there's nothing nobody can do about it.
Right.
You follow? Because there was other guys there that they had weapons and armor to fight just as much, but they didn't have the desire or the heart. And we read earlier about that heart that was in David. I think Samuel Solis had the 8th chapter there read about that Yahweh's going to put it in his heart in order to do the things that right. he's going to desire to do in the 13th chapter there. We had that read earlier. This is the heart thing that we're dealing with, or that light. Keep reading.
33, and Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against the Philistine to fight with them, for thou art but a youth, and he's a man of war from his youth.
And we know that Joshua said, unless you become as a little child, you're not going to inherit the kingdom of Yahweh. You follow? So we have a type of shadow of David being a youth and having come down to this state, because their conscience is like this darkness down here when it came to Goliath. It's like we get down and melancholy and disoriented when we have something that's insurpassable or insurmountable, that we don't feel that Yahweh not looking out after us. You follow? So he said he came down. He came down to bring them some food. That's what he was sent there to do in the first place. He got wind of this conversation
right.
about this Goliath.
Yeah.
He's not up here high and mighty talking about, I'm going to come in and do this and that.
Yeah.
He down here with them. And he asking them questions about this Goliath. And what are we going to do about this guy?
Yeah.
Right? And now he began to talk to Saul, and now David's speaking. Right? Read.
34. Mm-hmm. And David said unto Saul,
yeah.
thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock.
Mm-hmm.
And I went out after him and smote him mm-hmm. and delivered it out of his mouth.
See, that flock is taking... that he was taken of Jesse as a type in the shadow, just like that flock that Moses had of Reuel out here on the backside of this mountain. You follow? You know, we got another repeat happening up here about this
right.
David taking care of his father's flock. Mm-hmm. Moses took care of his father-in-law's flock. You follow? Then we know that Moses was a special prepared body that what received the word of Yahweh, the name of Yahweh, as it were, right? The first man that received the name of Yahweh. And now we have David. Let's see what he's going to do.
35. And mm-hmm. I went out after him and smote him and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose again against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and slew him.
Mm-hmm.
Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and their uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living Elohim.
They're the armies. Now, you go back in history. I am not going to put it together and tie it in right now, but it's been expressed. You got a lion and a bear
right
back here in Babylon. You got Medes and Persia. You follow? This lion and the bear is indicative of what Samuel, David is speaking of, because these are warring nations. Babylon was a warring nation, and Medes and Persians were warring nations. These were nations that were rulers of the then known world at their particular time in history. You follow? Warring nations, and you have David talking about him able to slay them, who took his father's sheep. Mm-hmm. They're not his sheep, but his father's sheep that he went out to protect and to bring home.
Right.
You follow? And to save and to protect. Mm-hmm. That's what this is all about. This is a gospel of salvation that we're learning about through events and times about patriarchs that experienced something that had the Holy
right.
Spirit in them. This is why we're saying it. I was listening and reading in 1 Kings today about Solomon being the wisest of them all. But man, I skipped to the 11th chapter. Solomon wasn't all that wise. At the end of the day, and it's surprised, and I didn't realize that like that,
yeah.
you know. So, already saying that, you know, they wrote by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is really true, because at the end of their days, they weren't about nothing,
mm-hmm.
and they didn't do right all the time, which was what the commandment of Yahweh: love Yahweh with all that heart and all that soul. But then we can see instances through David being anointed, David wanting to fight for Yahweh, because he's going to talk about it. Keep reading right now.
37.
He's talking about his bear, his experiences. He done come down, and he's experienced all of this, because this is a round trip circle. It goes up and down. We know this migratory pattern comes up and down. Why? Because you got those 70 souls that had already been in Canaan's land under the auspices of Abraham. Those souls through Isaac and Jacob. Jacob's name changed into Israel, and those 70 souls, because of a famine, Yahweh pushing them down into Egypt, right? And Joseph, and we know that Joseph was like unto Elohim, unto his people. You right. follow? Already down here, waiting to receive them. But see, they had went through some things. And now we coming back up, and David saying he's already went through some things about fighting a bear and a lion.
Right.
Now let's see what he got to say about it.
37. David said, moreover, Yahweh that delivered me out of the paws of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine.
What make him have the audacity to say that? And that's a lion, and we just think that's a lion and a bear, but we've been taught about Russia. We've been taught about Babylon. We have a whole history about pagan Rome and papal Rome. And we say the school of the highest learning. And when you learn something, you have to go forth and do some work after you get out of school. Now, we know we're never out of school, but yet we do have some tools and information in order for us to combat the wiles of the world. And know that Yahweh, just as David said, he will protect me. You follow? He will guard me through whatever it is I have to go through. But we have to have a positive attitude in favor of Yahweh. I think we read it in the scripture today, but I'm not going to find it yet. Let's finish up with David, and we'll go from there.
37. And Saul said unto David, go, and Yahweh be with thee. And Saul armed David with his armor, and he put a helmet of brass upon his head.
Just like Dr. Salas went over today, right? Go ahead.
He armed him with a coat of mail. And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he essayed to go, for he was not used to it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with these, for I am not used to them. And David put them off him. And he took his staff in his hand and chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag.
See, that old armor that Saul had, Saul being that wicked one, being satanic, is that armor of the world, as it were. That armor that Saul had, because we already saw it, Dr. Samuel saw it 3 times. He's denied Yahweh, essentially, not believing in Yahweh. And now you got Saul putting on his armor,
right?
The wiles of the world onto David. And David said he's not used to that.
Right.
Because he was a youth. And we know that those children of Israel that crossed over the River Jordan, that was a new breed of people. You follow? And now that in the type and in the principle, you have David being that youth and having no fear. Having had gone through the lion and the bear and experiences in order to be able to stand on the word of Yahweh and not take on or go back and put on that old garment.
Right.
Or put on that old man, as it were.
Right.
Which was the shields and the helmet that Saul was trying to bear onto David.
Yeah.
You follow?
Yeah.
But now David said, no, I have none of it. Keep reading.
Even in a scrip, and his sling was in his hand.
Now, a script is a bag. A script is not a script of conversation. There's a bag that he had, and he's going to put these 5 stones in there. Keep reading.
And he drew near to the Philistine. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David.
Yes.
And the man that bare the shield went before him.
Now that 5 stones, now I'm not privy on the 5 brothers of the 4 brothers of Goliath, but those 5 stones represents the spirit that he's picking up. Because 5 in numerology,
right,
you have 5 depicting spirit. And therefore, he's able, and out of that river brook, he's able to pick up those stones with their smooth, okay? And now he's having that spirit in him in order to go fight this giant, right? Yeah. Read.
42. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. Mm-hmm. And the Philistine said unto David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? Mm-hmm. And the Philistine cursed David by his idols. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of Yahweh of hosts.
See right there? David ain't just coming out of the field. He coming with a name.
That's right.
And he's already said that he believe in Yahweh. Yahweh going to deliver him out of it because he already went through something.
That's right.
We've already went through this information and understanding that the true name is Yahshua the Messiah.
Yep.
You follow? And to go back, as some has gone back and to deny the name of Yahshua Messiah, as though it holds no weight, is blasphemy, as it were. Is against the tenets of this school.
Right.
In order to deny that name. It's in the aims that there's only one name unto salvation. And we have this little runt, David, and we read about, everybody in the whole world done read about. But he didn't come by the name of the Lord. He came by the name of Yahweh.
That's right.
You follow? And what'd he do?
The Elohim of the armies of Israel.
See, he's also the Elohim. And this is why we impart about the unity, the understanding that there's one name. He coming by the name of Yahweh and the title of Elohim. Mm-hmm. You follow? This is how David running down, the second king of Israel. Read.
46. This day will Yahweh deliver thee into my hand.
There's only one day we're working with.
Yep.
Not working with seven solar days. We're working with one day. Yahweh created the heavens and earth in one day. Mm-hmm. And this is the day that he's going to destroy it. Read.
And I will smite thee
He's going to destroy it. That concept of Goliath being a mammoth of a man, mm-hmm. being a giant in the land. You follow? And being fearful. And you down here looking, they down here dealing with that. Because he doesn't get his seat until after Saul expires. So he working a work coming up out of here, and I haven't studied enough to be able to pull all the principles out from him being a runt and coming all the way up through here in order to don his crown in the most holy place, as it were. But keep reading, that's another story.
And I will give the carcasses of the hosts of the Philistine this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is an Elohim in Israel.
See, we talking about this gospel shall be preached throughout all the earth, right?
Yep.
In the 24th chapter there in Matthew. But David's speaking the same gospel, speaking unto Goliath, or to the world, to the tall giant of the land, just like we have what appears to be tall giants out here. And we are growing in order to have a voice, in order to believe in Yahshua, in order to fight and stand in your day, or in your hour,
right,
against that big giant that's going, you're going to have to deal with.
Right.
And everybody's going to have to be able to deal with them.
That's right.
In their own way, from the youth all the way up. But if they believe in Yahweh, this is what will happen. Read.
47. And all this assembly shall know that Yahweh saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is Yahweh's, and he will give you into our hands.
See, not with sword and spear. That's exactly what Saul was trying to give David. David out here teaching or letting us know, because no one in the now known Christendom have any idea what that means.
Yeah.
They saying that he ain't coming in the name of the Lord. And there's a big difference, the name of the Lord and the name of Yahweh. Have certain people, I don't even fight it much anymore, but certain people asking people about the names on social media and stuff, and don't none of them give any credits. It doesn't matter what the name is. It's close enough. It does, you know, any of that is a moot point. So coming back here and learning all of these stories and events, they're just tales to people. That's just, that was David's doing with Goliath. No, that's Yahweh's doing with David. You follow? It's not separate. There's one spirit, we say, from Yahshua that came in to fulfill. What was he fulfilling? Just the law? No, he was fulfilling this whole kit and caboodle. Mm-hmm. From whence that first sin came into mankind. He come in in order to redeem them that were under the law. Remember, that law was put on the people because of sin. Yahweh got rid of Yahweh had a partial end to the world at this end of during the end of the antediluvian age, that whole known world. David would say he's going to kill Goliath to make it known to the whole known world that Elohim is fighting for them. Mm-hmm. Yahweh let it be known here.
Sure did. Through
Noah and that flood. But why? Because he didn't preach. Because they didn't believe the report that Noah was giving for 120 years. And Yahshua is fulfilling all of this. Types and shadows. He's fulfilling what David has done and is going to do. You follow? So these are the things that we're looking back at and reflecting on that spirit. Mm-hmm. Yahweh, Yahshua, is the Holy Spirit in a body. He was in the body when Samuel saw that little boy come up out of the field. And he said, this eighth one, or that new day, or new ones, the new generation, is going to be the one. Samuel saw it. Jesse ain't see it. His daddy didn't see it.
Right.
His biological daddy didn't see that David was anything. He's just some kid taking care of sheep.
Yep.
But as Samuel, who, as Dr. Samuel Salas said, he didn't know Yahweh Elohim either. When he first came into Eli's house and stayed up there at that temple and was sleeping there, he had to come out three times. And until he said, "Here I am, I," and Yahweh spoke to him. You follow? Mm-hmm. And he believed in Yahweh. And remember, he killed that guy, he killed that king from that one land that Saul didn't kill. Mm-hmm. So we're dealing with slaying theories, concepts, and opinion. That's what we're reading in that story. And no, we're not going to be gathered together with no bayonets and swords, neither running around trying to kill nobody. We're saying that individually, ourselves, psychologically, we have to see that Yahweh is fighting our battles according to our theories, concepts, and opinions. That's what's being slayed, you would. That's and we believe in the spirit that's going to lead us, and not our swords and our weapons and our shields and our armor of how we think we've been trying to get through this life. Not in righteousness, peace, and joy, but just barely get through this life. Let alone what righteousness, peace, and joy is. You might get it on a holiday. You might get it on your best birthday.
Yeah.
But as you get old and things get hard, you still should have righteousness, peace, and joy.
That's right.
This is what we're fighting for. Mm-hmm. This is what we're reading and going over and rehearsing these events of time in order to draw out the principles of the Holy Spirit. But keep reading about Samuel right quick.
48. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David.
Mm-hmm.
David hasted and ran towards the army to meet the Philistine.
See, running towards. He didn't just creeping around and trying to hide and doing. He running straight to that giant with all assurity, with all gospel. He running to it. And what's he do?
And David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone.
While he's running, pop, pop. He got his script. He's pulling that sling out, and he begins to wound up. Keep reading.
And slanged it.
And smote
the Philistine in his forehead.
Yep.
That the stone sunk into the forehead.
Whoop.
And he fell upon his face to the earth.
Uh-huh.
So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone. And smote the Philistine.
Didn't the Pharaoh get slayed down here in the Red Sea?
Yep.
He got smoked. And those 600 horsemen and those 600 chariots and all the king's horses, they fell in this sea in the day. In the day, they fell in this sea. Mm-hmm. Sure is dead. And now he got that stone sunk deep into that giant's head, and he fell over. What's he do with it after that?
But there was no sword in the hand of David.
Oh, my goodness. See, that tongue that we wield around, that we've hurt people with, and we did a lot of damage with, that's that sword that needs to be rightly divided of the word of truth. Mm-hmm. You follow? That little small udder or rudder called the tongue. Mm-hmm. You follow? That's why you have this law up here. You see? Or this mouth of that law. And we have to become perfect in the law in order to discern how to cut and what to cut in order to not hurt the people, but to pull them out of this darkness or out of their ignorance. Right. We're not going around trying to maim people or hurt people or put them under the altar, if you would, and kick them into the fire. We're trying to pull people out of the fire. So we're getting sharp in our understanding about this gospel, about the migratory pattern, about the events of the judges, the situation with Saul and David and Samuel. When we read about that, we should be getting strength and confidence that the story's all going together, because we can run a timeline. Whew. We can run a timeline from Joshua all the way back through these 490 year cycles is what we're pulling from, and then all the way back, and we read there in I think the second chapter of Luke when it runs the genealogies of Yahshua the Messiah, mm-hmm. all the way back to Seth, to Abel, and Adam, mm-hmm. all the sons of Elohim. Right. We're not missing nothing. But as we get confident in that, this and that's just showing forth, that's the physical manifestation that we can tie in the patriarchs all the way to who Yahshua is. That's a type and a shadow of us seeing the principle of the Holy Spirit operating. We're not asking nobody to memorize all the patriarchs, the 64 generations. We're not asking that. Now, if you have a strong grasp and you can pull that out, in order to convince and convey somebody about that Holy Spirit operating and doing the work, that they might believe in that, because you're sure not going to get into heaven just rattling off the names. But we're saying, hey, if you understand the purpose and the pattern, we use these charts as tools. This man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern is a tool to show you how you are threefold. Head region, chest region, and abdominal region, how that correlates to this tabernacle pattern. And we know that we can go into a great detail about this tabernacle pattern. So much so, we have modules, models. Dr. Samuel Salas is a craftsman of this of a sort, right?
Yeah.
What people do, what we've done, and how does this go together, Doc? Just a small rendition of the things that we practice with to see the intricacy of this tabernacle. And how the I don't know how the cloths go on here, but you know, it covers, I'm sure this is gonna cut the, is the last one?
Yeah.
Probably like this one?
Red, yeah.
The white one's the last one? White one, yeah, you got three skins, right? Just like you got three parts of skin of your body. Nonetheless, I'm just saying that when you handle even little modules like this, you're coming into an understanding about the tabernacle, how things are put together, knowing that there's 206 bones or pillars, boards, and what bars in order to make up one's body. But that all goes into having the confidence that David had in order to slay Goliath. You follow? Mm-hmm. Keep reading there and delay. There's something I want to get out of here with what David does to this Goliath guy. After he done killed him, he done fell down. Keep reading.
51. Therefore, David ran and stood upon the Philistine.
Yep.
Took his sword and drew it out of the sheath thereof and slew him.
Took his own sword, Goliath's sword.
Yep.
Because David didn't have no sword.
Right.
Now David's going to do what to this guy?
And cut off his head therewith.
Mm.
And when the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled.
Hmm.
And the men of Israel and Judah rose and shouted and pursued the Philistines
mm-hmm.
until they came into the valley and to the gates of Ekron.
Mm-hmm.
And wounded the Philistines fell down by the way to Shaaraim,
mm-hmm.
even unto Gath and unto Ekron. And the children of Israel returned from chasing after the Philistines,
mm-hmm.
and they spoiled their tents. And David took the head of the Philistine mm-hmm. and brought it to Jerusalem.
Mm.
But he put his armor in his tent. And when Saul saw David go forth against the Philistines, and he said unto Abner, the captain of the host, Abner, whose son is this youth?
Huh.
And Abner said, as thy soul liveth, O king, I cannot tell.
Hmm.
And the king said, inquire thou whose son the stripling is. And as David returned from the slaughter of the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand.
Mm-hmm.
And Saul said to him, whose son art thou, thy young man? And David answered, I am the son of thy servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite. Mm-hmm. Go to 18.
Mm. Yeah.
And it came to pass when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul.
See, that's why I talked about earlier about David and Jonathan being Saul's son, being knit together as their own soul, because, hey, that satanic nature was in his dad, Saul. And so you have that connection of Jonathan looking out for David, because you have the same characteristic of that cousin, John the Baptist, and Yahshua the Messiah, because John the Baptist had that Holy Spirit, just as Jonathan had the Holy Spirit, in order to move to tell David, forewarning David, as it were, Saul's coming for you. You need to flee into the mountains. You need to go here. It does it a number of times. But then you still have this character here, John the Baptist, looking out for Yahshua, whereby John's purpose was to call out the Son of Yahweh, right? When he saw this dove or this spirit descend like a dove onto Yahshua the Messiah. So you have that in a type that Yahshua has someone who's going to bear witness to who he is, right? And that's where that knitting comes together, because while they were in the wombs of Mary and Elizabeth, the souls or the spirit leaped one to another, making that connection. You follow? So the same thing with Saul and David and Jonathan. You follow? This is how you can use the scriptures in order to see how Yahshua is fulfilling them in various manners and shapes, because, you know, like David said, with the name of Yahweh, this is why he's doing that. He's not doing it just because it's David and he think he has a little one up, that he think he has some skills. No, he's doing it because the Holy Spirit is moving him to do that. You follow? And we need to be ever mindful that anything we read according to the scriptures is the Spirit moving them to do that. You follow? That's good with there. Let's go to the 1 John 5 right quick. We got a few minutes. Anybody have any questions? I know it's not question and answer night, but Dr. Samuel, I love what he expressed and given a nice narrated rundown of what we kind of had went over. And again, we're going to stay up here. We're going to get into David a little bit more, and then we'll probably be able to skip right over to Solomon pretty quick. You have a question, Doc?
Consult a witch, because Yahweh don't speak to him no more.
That's right.
He went to talk to Samuel, but Samuel was already dead. But he requests the witch.
Oh, that's the 28th chapter. Man, that's a doozy right there, too. The 28th chapter. That's what you're talking about.
Yeah. To bring him.
Yeah.
And the witch called him, hey, come over, Samuel. Come. And finally, Saul see Samuel coming.
Let me do it real quick, man. Let me do it real quick. 28th chapter of Saul. Yeah. I think I can do it pretty quick.
The beginning, when he started looking for it.
Talking about Saul.
Yeah.
And go ahead and start at the beginning. Now, look, you mind you, that this tabernacle go up and down, right? The high priest on the Day of Atonement is the first, only time he's allowed to go in here. Come up and down. And that three times in that one day on the Day of Atonement, October 15th. But then we have a period of time that they're working through this gate, the first step, altar, second, third, the brazen laver, fourth, the door with the holy cup of anointing oil, step five, the entire workings of the holy place, and the sixth step, or the second compartmental veil, and the seventh step, the most holy place. Now, King Saul was in the most holy, he was anointed. We read that earlier. He was anointed here, was able to furnish, right? But then, you know, he's not on the throne or nothing, but he's in that state, being able to be anointed of Yahweh. But see, he's going to have to fall. True? Mm-hmm. He done worked his way up in the children of Israel wanting a king. Now he's going to work his way back out. Start reading.
Mm-hmm. 1 Samuel 28. And it came to pass in those days that the Philistines gathered their armies together for warfare to fight with Israel.
I think we'll skip down a little bit, but
and
keep going.
And Achish said unto David, know thou assuredly that thou shalt go out with me to battle, thou and thy men. And David said to Achish, surely thou shalt know what thy servant can do. And Achish said to David, therefore will I make thee keeper of my head forever. Now Samuel was dead, and all Israel had lamented him, and buried him in Ramah.
Now Samuel's dead, okay?
Mm-hmm. Even in his own city.
Uh-huh.
And Saul had put away those that had familiar spirits and the wizards out of the land.
Okay.
And the Philistines gathered themselves together and came and pitched in Shunem. And Saul gathered all Israel together, and they pitched in Gibeah. And when Saul saw the host of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart greatly trembled. And when Saul inquired of Yahweh, Yahweh answered him not.
What verse you at?
6.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Yahweh answered him not, neither by dream, nor by Urim, nor by prophet. Then said Saul
Yahweh's in the most holy place. You follow? And he's not intercessing. He don't have an intercessor no more. King Saul don't have an intercessor in Samuel anymore. You follow? And now Yahweh, in the seventh step, he's not connected to Saul anymore. Now Saul began to panic. Got a question?
What's Urim?
A what?
Not by Urim.
I'm not sure what Urim means.
Mm-mm.
Huh? Okay. Okay.
He got it in his pocket.
Use the mic and say that, Doc. Grab the mic right there by your leg.
Well, the high priest in his left side is a pocket and the coat, and he have a pocket with two stones, Urim and Tumim. When he have an answer, he don't know how to solve the problem, he roll the two stones, and the stone tell him the answer.
Hmm. Wow.
Okay, now, he don't have that no more,
yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Because he's already marked to lose his spot, right? And so now, he had no connection with Yahweh. Hmm. Keep reading.
7. Then said Saul unto his servant, seek me a woman that has a familiar spirit.
Now he's trying to find some spirit. Yahweh's spirit. He's not talking to him, but now he's going to go about and call himself finding his own familiar spirit. You follow? A woman at that. Mm-hmm. You follow? Keep reading.
That I may go to her and inquire of her. Mm-hmm. And his servant said to him, behold, there is a woman that has a familiar spirit at Endor.
And now, Saul, in Endor, there's this woman that got some kind of spiritual prowess. Go ahead and read.
And Saul disguised himself and put on other raiments.
Now, he's putting on this raiment and other garb. Saul's trying to hide himself. Keep reading.
And he went and two men with him.
Now, he got two men, right, like into archangels and trying to be like somebody, right? You got
right,
three of them now. Mm-hmm. The spirit trying to be like the Most High. Keep reading.
There you go. And they came to the woman by night, and he said.
Now they come in by night, and just like Nicodemus came to Yahshua Messiah by night. You follow?
Right.
Keep reading.
I pray thee, inquire for me by the familiar spirit.
Now she's trying to have. Now they here at this altar trying to intercess with Yahweh, right? And he's trying to use this woman. Had that familiar spirit. Read.
And bring me him up, whom I shall name unto thee. And the woman said unto him, mm-hmm, behold, thou knowest what Saul has done, how he hath cut off those that have familiar spirits and the wizards out of the land. Wherefore then layest thou a snare for my life to cause me to die?
See, she went back and called Samuel to arise. And now she's realizing that this guy that came hiding is actually Saul. And she's saying, hey, you're going to cause me to have problems with these spirits, mm-hmm, right? He lying, number one, hiding in wolf's clothing. But keep reading.
And Saul swear to her by Yahweh, saying,
uh-huh,
as Yahweh liveth, there shall no punishment happen to thee for this thing.
Like Saul got some power now. He already can't talk to Yahweh. How he know him? But keep reading.
Yeah. 11. Then said the woman, whom shall I bring up unto thee?
Uh-huh.
And he said, bring me up Samuel.
Yeah.
And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried with a loud voice.
Okay.
And the woman spake to Saul, saying, why hast thou deceived me? For thou art Saul.
Uh-huh.
And the king said unto her, be not afraid, for what sawest thou? And the woman said unto Saul, I saw, as it were, Elohim ascending out of the earth.
Mm.
And he said unto her, what form is he of? And she said, an old man cometh up,
mm-hmm,
and he is covered with a mantle. And Saul perceived that it was Samuel, and he stooped his face to the ground and bowed himself.
He said, that's Elohim. She said, he saw like Elohim. But he's got the spirit that was in the man at that time, looking like Samuel. And he's pulling Samuel up out of this sleep. He'll tell you. Keep reading.
And Samuel said to Saul, why hast thou disquieted me,
mm-hmm,
to bring me up?
Mm-hmm.
And Saul answered, I am sore distressed.
Mm-hmm.
For the Philistine make war against me, and Elohim is departed from me. And answer me no more, neither by prophet nor by dreams.
He had a problem. He got some stress going on within himself.
Yep.
Some worry, right? Read.
Therefore, I have called thee that thou mayest make known unto me what I shall do.
Mm-hmm.
Then said Samuel, wherefore thou doest thou ask of me, seeing Yahweh is departed from thee and is become thy enemy.
Mm.
And Yahweh has done for himself as he spake by me. For Yahweh has rent the kingdom out of thy hand and given it to thy neighbor.
Then wouldn't this veil rent, this kingdom, or this veil rent from Saul? I understand. I'm picking that Solomon temple, that veil being rent. He's coming out. I'm going to show that he's coming out of this tabernacle, mm-hmm, and losing his vestige, if you would. He got his two, he's got his garment that he's hiding, being like, right, the garments of beauty and glory. He got his two witnesses, if you would. And then now that you got this rent, that y'all would rent the kingdom from him. Kingdom, seven steps, is being rent from him. Keep reading.
18. Because thou obeyest not the voice of Yahweh, nor executed his fierce wrath upon Amalek. Therefore has Yahweh done this thing unto thee this day.
See, there's a structure and function. We say that every class within this tabernacle. And Saul, he didn't cut the mustard. Read.
Moreover, Yahweh will also deliver Israel with thee into the hands of the Philistine.
Mm-hmm.
And tomorrow shall thou and thy sons be with me. Yahweh also shall deliver the host of Israel.
See, with Solomon, because Samuel's already dead. He's already knowing, prophesying that he, Saul, and his three sons are going to be dead, right? Yeah. But keep reading.
Yahweh also shall deliver the host of Israel into the hand of the Philistine.
Uh-huh.
Then Saul fell straightway all along on the earth and was so afraid because of the words of Samuel. And there was no strength in him, for he had eaten no bread all day nor all night.
Now here you go, your bread. He'd not eaten no substance. And he fell along the earth. And what I'm saying, these candlesticks, don't we have Yahshua, Elohim, walking down through the ages and dispensations, right, walking through the earth plane, as it were? And we see John on the Isle of Patmos looking, turning back and looking at this Elohim in all his beauty and glory. So you have Saul then laid down on this earth or on this candle or on the light that was going to be able to be expressed to him. You follow? And now you got that substance that he didn't eat, right? All day. He ain't done nothing.
Yep.
And he's laying down here, lights out. He having no light in Saul no more. That's what I'm saying. Across the earth. Don't we walk, people living on the earth plane, but there's no light in them? So he's just dead upon the earth. This is what these seven branches stand for. 7 days of the creation, or the ages in 7 days, 7 ages, 7 dispensations. This is our earth plane, right? This earth rightly divided, the history and time. He's laying down in death, in darkness, according to that light. That light's out of him. And he's not eating any intercessor. And he's talking to Samuel, being that intercessor. Keep reading.
And the woman came unto Saul and saw that he was so troubled and said unto him, behold, thy handmaiden has obeyed thy voice, and I have put my life in my hand, and have hearkened unto thy word, which thou spakest unto me.
Yep.
Now therefore, I pray thee, hearken thou also unto the voice of thy handmaid, and let me set a morsel of bread before thee, and eat, that thou mayest have strength when thou goest on thy way.
Mm-hmm.
But he refused and said, I will not eat. But his servant, together with the woman, compelled him, and he hearkened unto their voice.
Yes.
So he arose from the earth and sat upon the bed. And the woman had a fat calf in the house, and she hasted and killed it. And
don't you put that calf on? Don't we put that altar on this on this altar as a sacrifice? Keep reading. I'm almost done.
And took flour and kneaded it and did break unleavened bread thereof.
Uh-huh.
And she brought it before Saul and before his servants, and they did eat. Then they arose up.
Where did they do that Passover at? In the court round about down here? And where did they pass out? Where did they go through?
And they arose up and went away that night.
Through this gate out of this tabernacle during the night. All during the night, or the darkness of that. No light in that, in Saul, depicting and showing forth Saul's darkness by the tabernacle pattern of coming out. That's the best I can do with that. I'm very sorry for having gone over time. If you got anything out of that, all praises to Yahweh, our Elohim, by way of Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude our class for tonight. Is there any announcements?
Stay tuned. Keep coming to class.
Stay tuned. Keep coming to class. Zoom, YouTube. We appreciate you. We hold classes on every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 to 9:30, and from Sundays from 11 to 1. Please rise and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.